Ja, so in today's session, ja, on Applied Mathematical Finance, I like to discuss the valuation of simple options, yeah, basic options on interest rates. So we started discussing interest rate structures. And one thing I like to recall from one of our last sessions is the valuation of the floater. So in the valuation of the floater, yeah, we derived actually in two different ways this little valuation formula. So at a earlier time, little g, the value of the floater is given by this formula. So what was the floater? So the floater paid the forward rate fixed at the beginning of the period at the end of this interest rate period. Well, multiplied with the period length and maybe multiplied also with some constant, the notional. And the value of the floater was that forward rate observed at an earlier point in time, multiplied with the period length and also with the notional, so multiplied by these constant, multiplied with the zero coupon bond that pays 1 unit at the payment time. So recall that the zero coupon bond with maturity TI plus one observed in TI plus one is equal to one. So that was the value of one individual payment, and then the value of the whole sequence was just the sum. Since we have that this here is equal to one, I could actually just right here in this definition of the floater, instead of say writing that it pays in TI plus one, so maybe just I remove this here. Instead of just writing that it pays this in TI plus one, I could write that it pays this multiplied with P TI plus one. Okay, then it pays this in TI plus one, but now you get the story. Actually, the valuation is just using now this. So since here I wrote the time, I have to add the time here too. At an earlier point in time. Yeah? So this argument here and that argument here is replaced by an earlier point in time, little t. Actually, we can say we paid this at an earlier point, say in TI. Now, that was our little trick, moving the payment date. Instead of paying 1 unit at the end, I can pay that times the zero coupon bond in TI. Okay, and now I can actually maybe remove, or that here is maybe something in addition. Yeah, maybe it's a little bit redundant, but because I already see, okay, it's paying multiples of the zero coupon bond in TI plus one in TI. So, and we can move this payment date, but we cannot move before TI. So that was also a part when we derived this. And you see there are two parts here. There is something which I pay, so the index. And then there is the unit in which I pay it. Yeah? So I pay in units of the zero coupon bond. And when you value it, it's just the same observed at an earlier point in time. So yeah, maybe this is a little bit trivial, yeah, so that I can multiply with the zero coupon bond. But when we discuss now these options, this scheme will reappear. And before I discuss now the options on the interest rates, I would like to give you a small repetition of the Plec-Scholes model and the derivation of the Plec-Scholes formula. And Also, why do I give this repetition? It's to give you more intuition, yeah, and also have this lecture being self-contained. So you have now the derivation of the Black-Scholes formula in your script, or here on these slides, and there is then the opportunity to link back to this, and maybe you will also get a deeper understanding for the Black-Scholes model and actually the role of the choice of numeria. Okay, so let's have this quick repetition of the derivation of the Black-Scholes formula. So here I assume that the interest rates are deterministic, yeah, but only in this small section here. And I assume that there is some bank account, which we can consider as a traded product. So I can put money in, I can buy units of this bank account. So this bank account here is the product B. Yeah, it evolves with DB is R times B dt. So, and since I initially start in B0 equal to 1, I know the solution. It's exponential integral R of tau d tau from 0 to t. So that is one financial product in my market. And then I have another financial product, and that one is the stock. So the stock S follows this stochastic process. And here I formulate the SDE under the real measure P. Yeah, so it's not yet the equivalent martingale measure. And I have a constant, I have a parameter here in my model that is the parameter sigma. So sigma is deterministic. It may depend on time. If sigma is constant, it's called the Black-Scholes volatility. Okay, so in the derivation now of the option pricing formula, so option pricing formula, I would like to evaluate this payoff. So at a future point in time, say capital T, we pay the maximum of S of T minus K. So the stochastic process S evaluated at capital of T, yeah, so that random variable minus K, the maximum of this and zero, paid in capital T. And we like to value it. So value here means I like to calculate actually, assuming that risk neutral replication hedging is possible, I would like to calculate the cost of replication. So using the universal pricing theorem. So I assume I can move to an equivalent martingale measure once I have chosen a numeraire. Okay, so what is the numeraire that we choose? We have two assets on the market, the B and the S. Okay, let's choose B as the numeraire. So that's the next step in the derivation. We choose B as our numeraire. And then we move to the equivalent martingale measure. So that means the equivalent martingale measure. Yeah, let's use here a different color. So that is S divided by B is a martingale under this measure. So it's a QB or Q superscript N. Yeah, since N is our numeraire, N is equal to B, martingale. So I assume that this measure exists. So there are certain conditions. Yeah, for example, sigma is larger than zero and so on. Then you can move, yeah, with Gesanov to this measure. Okay, what does S divided by B look under this measure? So I just apply Itô's lemma. So this here is Itô's lemma. And you see that it's S divided by B times DS minus S divided by B times DB, and then comes the second order term. Yeah, but the second order term has a dt times dt or dt times dt here or dt times dw, so that one vanishes. And so it's because the db only has a dt term. And what's in, at the end, what's left is mu times dt minus r times dt. So I have this term here in front of the dt plus sigma dw, everything multiplied with s divided by b. And now, since we know that this guy is a martingale, so this is a qn martingale, so it means that this here has to be 0 dt. So that one is equal to 0 dt. So the drift is 0. So I know that under qn, the mu, mu qn, so the mu depends on this choice, is equal to r. So actually, instead of, that is a nice trick in this setup, instead of actually deriving how the measure looks, you derive how the process looks under this measure. Okay, so we know that the mu is equal to r under this measure. Under the equivalent martingale measure, I know now the mu is equal to r. So I can plug in the mu. The next step is that you move to a different coordinate system. So you know that ds is equal to something plus sigma s dw. So it's a log normal process. If you move to the logarithm, the s in front of the dw vanishes. But since I have a stochastic process, I get also another second order term in the dt part, which is the minus 1/2 sigma dt. So here is another application of Ito's lemma. So it's again Ito, which tells me how does the logarithm of s looks like. So what is the stochastic process of the logarithm of s? Okay, so why is this helpful? Yeah, it's because we can now easily infer the probability distribution of log of S of capital T. Because this Ito process, I can integrate it. I know its solution. And there is just some function here, sigma of T dw. So I can integrate it. And I know that the result is a normal distributed random variable. So we conclude that log S of capital T has normal distribution. And I know the mean. The mean is the initial value of the stochastic process plus the integral of the drift part. Yeah. So it's the initial value here plus, this is my initial value, plus the integral of the drift part, which gives me here the mean mu. And I also know the standard deviation. The standard deviation is the integral of the sigma dw, squared. Yeah. So the this gives me the integrated variance. So it's the square root of, which color should I use? Yeah, maybe I take that one here. So I get also the sigma, so which is the integral of sigma squared dt. Yeah, so there is the Ito isometry maybe behind here, or just knowing the Brownian motion. Yeah, so integrating dw is the Brownian motion, so it's w of capital T minus w of zero. Then I introduce a parameter sigma bar, which is actually 1 divided by t times this integral. And then if I take the square root, it's the standard deviation is sigma bar times square root of t. Okay. So sigma bar times square root of t is the standard deviation of this random variable. So now I know that distribution of logarithm of S of capital T. It has this mean and that standard deviation. And hopefully I can now calculate the expectation of our payoff. So hopefully I can now calculate the expectation of this divided by the numerator under that measure. Okay, so the second step was, do we know the distribution of the random variables that are inside the expectation? Yes, we know it. Yeah. So here it's written again. Yeah. So logarithm of S of capital T is this constant plus a normal distributed random variable with mean zero and standard deviation sigma bar square root of T. So now I apply the universal pricing theorem. I know that the value of my option at observation time, say equals zero, is given by the numerator multiplied with the expectation of the value at a future point in time. And the value at the future point in time, which we plug in. Yeah, so I like to calculate the expectation of V divided by the numerator. The value which we plug in is that at time capital T. Okay, so I plug in here my value at payment time, or here it's the exercise time of the option, divided by the numerator. And a small observation is that here the numerator, so that is here my numerator, can move in front of the expectation operator. Yeah? So here the numerator is just a deterministic object, yeah, deterministic number. So it's not a random variable, so I can move it out of the expectation. And all I'm left with is now the expectation of a function, so maximum of s minus k and zero, where in this function there is a random variable of which I do know the distribution. And I know the logarithm of s is normal distributed, hence I write maximum of exponential of logarithm of s minus k and zero. And I need to calculate the expectation of this. So, and that's now, maybe you have to work a little bit, but it's actually straightforward, yeah, because expectation of a normal distributed random variable is an integral with respect to, yeah, the density. So I take the density of the normal distribution. So here, this is the density of the standard normal distribution, the phi. Okay, so I plug it in here. This is my density. And I just integrate the function that represents the payoff. It was maximum of the exponential of something which was normal distributed. So y minus k and zero. So I have to calculate this integral. And this guy here in front was my numerator. It's just a constant. So now we need to calculate this integral, and you can calculate this integral analytically, and you arrive at the Black-Scholes formula. So we get the Black-Scholes formula here. Okay, so very quickly, how do you derive this formula? So the formula is the option value is the value of the stock today as zero times capital phi of D plus. Capital phi is the cumulative distribution function of the standard normal minus exponential minus RT, yeah, so R bar, also the integral averaged of the R of T, if R depends on time, times K times capital phi D minus. And D plus or D minus is this little expression here. So that is my D plus or D minus. And you see that, maybe I draw that again. And you see that all those constants like initial value of S, the sigma, the R appear in this D plus minus. So how do you derive this formula? Okay, let's go very quickly through this. You can read it later. So you have to calculate this integral. So the first step which you do is that you have here this maximum function, maximum of this and zero, and you remove the maximum function by observing that this is equivalent to integrating just from a given lower bound. Yeah, so it is from integrating from logarithm of k to infinity. And then you see that in this integral, I have actually two parts. There is the exponential of y, so that is here, and there is a k. So actually I can split this into two integrals. So the first integral is that one that contains here the exponential y, and it's integrated, you know, or a convolution with the density, and the other one is just the constant k. So I have here the k times integrate the density, yeah. And you see that this is then the reason why here I have in the Black-Scholes formula, I also have two parts in the end. I have that part that contains the k and that part that contains the s. So the maximum is gone and I have now two integrals. So multiplying here these two exponentials is easy, yeah? So it's the exponential of the sum of the arguments. So let's look at this integral first, yeah? So you get here the exponential of the sum of the arguments. And then you can rewrite here this argument to something being squared, which then looks again a little bit like the density, but at a different location, so shifted, minus a constant. Okay, so that constant can be moved in front, yeah, because it's exponential of a sum. Yeah, this is like a product. I can move this in front. So I just have to integrate this, which looks very much like the density at a different point. So just shifted. And that's the reason why in the Black-Scholes formula, you get here the integral of the density at a certain point. And here you get it at another point. So that is solving the integral. Yeah? It's not such a big deal. So you do some substitution and you finally arrive at the evaluation of the density of the standard normal integrated from an argument here, which is a result of this substitution. And then you plug in cumulative distribution function of the standard normal. The integral with k is solved in the same way. So you define the distribution function of the standard normal distribution, and then you get this nice formula. Maybe one small remark. I will make this remark again in a few minutes. Yeah, for the interest rate derivatives. In the formula, only this integrated. The square root of the integrated variance appeared. Yeah. So this parameter sigma bar, which is something like the annualized, yeah, the average per year volatility, yeah, appears. And this parameter is then now called the Black-Scholes volatility. So it is actually the constant which I could use instead of the sigma of t to get the same option price. So that's something which you find in a textbook, yeah? So for the derivation of the Black-Scholes model, but to some extent it disguises a little bit what's going on. And we may walk through this derivation again and get maybe a somewhat generalized derivation, which will also then work for the interest rate derivatives when we look at them. And go back to this derivation and just check what was needed. So there was a choice of a certain numerea, yeah, and our numerea was e to the rt. So actually, but I could use any constant multiplied with this numerea. So I could also use e to the r little t multiplied with e to the minus r capital T. So that means I could also use as numerea here this m of t, which is e to the minus r capital T minus little t. And if I use that numerea, it has a special property. That numerea is 1 at the point where my option is exercised. So it's 1 actually at the point that appears in the expectation. Yeah. So that means if you use this numerea, it somehow manages that the numerea is here equal to 1 and only appears in front of the expectation. And you can also think of what is your option paying. The payoff of the option is maximum of s minus t, f s of t minus k and 0 multiplied with m of t. Okay, so multiplied with m of t. Because it's just 1. And then you see that in my Black-Scholes formula, actually there was, let's go back. So here in my Black-Scholes formula, there was an S of 0 in front of this here. And there was a k times e to the minus rt in front of that here. So actually, we could rewrite this. Let's rewrite this as v of 0, phi of t plus minus k times capital phi of t minus, and then write this e to the minus r bar t on the outside. So what do I need to write here? I need to write here s of 0 divided by the e to the minus r t, right? Yes. So that means in the notation, so maybe I write this a bit nicer here, e to the minus r t. In the notation on my other slide, this guy here is the m of 0, and this guy here is s of 0 divided by m of 0, right? Maybe I just define this as f of 0. If this is f of 0, what is f of capital T? F of capital T is just s of t. So I define f of little t is the ratio of s and my numerea, s of little t and m of little t. Then my payoff, so let's write the payoff here, in capital T is maximum of s of t minus k and 0. So, but I can also write here s of t divided by m of t, because m of t is equal to 1. And then I can just replace this by f of t. So f of t. And since the m of t is equal to 1, I can just multiply this with an m of t. And now you see that the Black-Scholes formula looks very much like just replace the capital T with the time at the evaluation point. So there is an M of zero here corresponding to this, and an F of zero here corresponding to this. And since we have this maximum here, actually there are some weights here coming in. And with respect to here the phi plus and phi minus, I would like to give you another nice intuition. A small remark here. What actually happens if sigma goes to zero? So if the stochastic processes are actually not stochastic, they remain deterministic. So sigma goes to zero. So for sigma going to zero, actually you see that here I divide by sigma. There's a sigma squared here. So the sigma squared divided by the sigma goes to zero. I don't care about this. So it's just that this part here in the Black-Scholes formula goes to infinity. Which infinity? So actually that depends if the logarithm here is a plus something or a minus something, if it's positive or negative. So that depends on if f is larger than k, then the logarithm is positive, or if f is smaller than k, then the logarithm is negative. So this means that the d plus minus, regardless if it is plus or the minus, yeah, because the sigma part doesn't matter, goes to plus infinity for f of zero larger than k, and minus infinity for f of zero smaller than k. And that means the phi of d plus minus, yeah, goes to 1 or 0. Depending on is f larger or smaller than k, which actually means that, okay, if k is larger, if f is larger than k, the phi plus and the phi minus go to 1. So then I have here f minus k. If f is smaller than k, then the phi d plus minus goes to 0. So that goes to 0. So actually, all this stuff goes to maximum of f minus k and 0. So it means that v of 0 goes to, it's not equal, goes to maximum of f of 0 minus k and 0 times m 0. And now look, that looks exactly as what we did for the floater. The evaluation formula is just the objects evaluated at evaluation time. Okay, only in this special case where the volatility goes to zero. But you see there is something going on here. There's something behind. And the intuition I would like to create now, and which we will use and see again and again, is that there are two special objects. There is the numerator m, and there is the index f, and the payment is a function of the index multiplied with the numerator. And then if we, in the expectation, divide by the numerator is vanishing. And there's another thing. Under our equivalent martingale measure, this object here is a martingale. So there is really a special structure in this setup. And this structure is maybe not seen if you just derive it in the classical way. Yes, you move the numerator out because it is deterministic, but it is seen now, and we will see this now again if we look at interest rates. So, let's now derive analytic valuation formula for some simple options on interest rates. I have several here. Yeah, we look at the caplet under the Black model. Yeah, so the option on the forward rate, the Bachelier model. Then we will also look at the swaption. And while all the four first ones are on the forward rate, we will also look at the swaption on the backward rate, which is actually the same as the swaption on the forward rate. So let's start with the caplet. Okay, so we consider here a caplet as defined here in our definition 149. So what was the caplet? So we pay maximum of the forward rate observed for a certain period. So we just choose here a period T1 to T2. The rate is fixed at the beginning of the period, so fixed in T1. And then we pay the maximum of this interest rate minus K, multiplied with the period length. So that was T2 minus T1. Okay, that's just a scaling factor. And that is paid at the end of the period, so in T2. So we look at this caplet for two times, and to ease a little bit the notation, I call this here L1, yeah, L1 for the L fixed at the beginning of the period T1. And I would like to value this option. So this here is the value we observed in T2, yeah, so at payment time. It's fixed at the beginning of the period, but it's paid at the end. So in at payment time, this is the value of the financial product. I postulate some model now. So I need a model. So while we could value the floater actually without a model, now I need a model. And I assume that L also follows a log normal model. So there's a log normal dynamic. So log normal dynamic here means that the driver is L times dW, or sigma L times dW. So this is the stochastic part here. So I assume that my L1 follows this model. So that is the model under the real measure. Yeah. So I assume here that this is the model under P, and we will move to the equivalent Martingale measure. Actually, if you are very strict, you will observe that to move to the equivalent Martingale measure, I need to apply Gersanov theorem. And for Gersanov theorem, I actually need some solvability. And in this solvability, the sigma should be not equal to zero. Yeah? So maybe this is larger than zero. But on the other hand, if sigma is always zero, then there's nothing to do. Okay, so maybe just fix this. So I like to value now this option under this model. So my payoff is maximum of L minus K, multiplied with the period length and zero. And now observe that there is a somewhat similar scheme. So which numerator should I use? So there is now a special choice that is has an advantage in two aspects. And that special choice is that we choose as numerator the bond that matures at payment time, so PT2. And what are the two aspects that are relevant here? So the first one is that this bond is somehow associated with the time at which we pay this value. So actually I can write here multiplied with PT2 observed in T2. right? Because that is just one. Actually, that should stand there because L has no unit and my payoff is in unit currency. So either I need one currency as a multiplier or I need some object that has unit one currency. Okay, so you see that there is something that I pay in units of this bond in the sense that I pay at this maturity. And there's a second aspect, and that second aspect is that my L is a martingale under the risk neutral measure that corresponds to this numeraire. So if you look at L1, the definition of L1 is bond at the beginning of the period minus bond at the end of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period divided by the period length. And you see that this is actually a portfolio divided by the numeraire. So this is the relative price of a traded asset. This is a portfolio divided by the numeraire. And if I assume that we can move to an equivalent martingale measure, yeah, so there are certain requirements, then I know that L is a martingale. So if L is a martingale, this means that there's no DT part. So maybe I write it like this. So this means that the E2 process is a zero DT plus a something DW. So like in the derivation of the Beck-Schultz model that we knew the mu is equal to R. So we knew that there is a certain constraint that there is no DT inside the DS by D, by the DS divided by B. I also know here the drift of L under this equivalent martingale measure. So again, this choice of numeraire is special in two aspects. It's somewhat linked to the payment time and it makes the object a martingale. So there is a certain structure that has to be fulfilled by this problem. It has to pay some object at the right time. Yeah? The right object at the right time. So the rest is very similar to what we just did. Since I know that this is a log normal model, so now I know that moving to the logarithm of L gives me this SDE, which tells me that the logarithm of L of capital T is a normal distributed random variable. So from that, we know that logarithm of L of T is normal distributed, and I can immediately read off the mean and the standard deviation of this random variable. The mean is just the integral of the drift part, so which is, since we move to the logarithm, the minus 1/2 sigma squared t plus the initial value, that is the mean. And the standard deviation is just here the sigma bar square root of t, where sigma bar is the integral of sigma squared divided by t and take the square root. So I can immediately read off the distribution of this random variable. So I know the distribution of logarithm of L1 of t. And another nice aspect is that if you now look at our valuation formula, the valuation formula is here. So this here is our universal pricing theorem. Yeah. There is another nice aspect. The N of capital T, this is my choice of numeraire was the zero Cooper bond that matures in K capital T, sorry, capital T2, so the n of capital T2, observed in capital T2, this is equal to 1. So you see that the numerator does not appear inside the expectation. So why does it not appear inside the expectation? So now you say because it is 1. Well, you could also think of this differently. Yeah? It does not appear inside the expectation because VT2 divided by N of T2 is the stuff that we pay divided by the numerator. So the stuff that we pay is maximum of L fixed in T1 minus K n0 multiplied with the period length. Okay. And now recall that I could interpret this as multiplying with the zero Cooper bond here. Yeah. So multiplying with the zero Cooper bond and this one cancels. Okay, I'm canceling a one, yeah, so that's trivial, but somehow maybe it's a little bit like this. I pay in units of this bond and I choose this bond as a numerator, then the numerator cancels. And I just have the expectation of the maximum of an index, which is in addition a martingale. So you see that actually this trick leads to the fact that the value at zero is equal to, so now you move this n zero here to the other side, so is equal to n of zero multiplied with, okay, so now I have to get rid of this little equal signs here, so let's move this here and make it a little bit of fat dot here, so multiplied with the expectation of maximum of L minus K times period length and zero. And you see that this special choice of the numerator leads to that the numerator moves out of the expectation in front of it, and the stuff inside the expectation is a function of a martingale. Okay, so we have some nice structure again. And now we are actually in the same situation than before. I have the maximum of something where logarithm of L1 T1 is normally distributed. So that is exactly the same situation as for the Black-Scholes model for the stock. So now you write maximum of the exponential of the logarithm, you plug in the density, you solve the integral. So we already did this. So you see that we just get the same Black-Scholes formula by knowing the distribution of L1 under the equivalent martingale measure. So, and the formula which I have here is now the Black-Scholes or the Black formula for the Black formula, it's called, for the value of a caplet. And you see that it has a very nice structure, just the same structure as before. So here, there is the numerator in front. The numerator was my bond at with maturity T2. And then it's multiplied with what was the F? F0. The F was the object. So let's go back to our Black-Scholes or our generalized Black-Scholes formula. So here our M was the numerator. And then I was paying F minus K. And F was an object that was a martingale under that numerator. And then my formula was F of zero, the forward, times capital phi of d plus minus k times capital phi of d minus, both multiplied with the numerator m at zero. So we get the same structure here. F at zero times phi of d plus minus k times phi of d minus multiplied with the numerator at zero. And that here was just a constant scaling factor. So I have derived the analytic formula for valuing a caplet. And you see, it is actually just Black-Scholes formula in the generalized sense, yeah, that we pay some index. We pay the function maximum of some index minus k and zero, multiplied with an asset, where the index is a martingale under the measure corresponding to the numerator being that asset. So you can go back now to the Black-Scholes model for the stock and derive it for this generalized situation. Assume you have a stochastic process I, which is an index, that is a martingale under the measure corresponding to the numerator m. If you then pay maximum of I minus k and zero multiplied with m at a future point in time, then this formula gives you the value of this option. Another remark on the volatility parameter. Yeah, so I already mentioned that in this formula, only the time average of the volatility in the sense of the square integral, the square root of the average of the square integral appears. So that parameter was on our slide, the sigma bar. Yeah. Yeah. So in the formula, only this sigma bar appears. So the value of this option is can be interpreted as a function of this sigma bar, given that all other parameters stay fixed. So like I did in this small experiment where I moved the sigma bar to zero, yeah, the sigma to zero. So you can interpret then the value as a function of this sigma bar. And then you can ask yourself, given an option price, which I observe at the market for a certain set of parameters. So in the case of the Black-Scholes model for a stock, there's also the parameter R. Yeah. So here, in case I'm looking at interest rates, that parameter here is not there. It is the initial value of L, zero. Yeah. For the stock, there's S, zero, and R. So let's fix this slide. So given that L0 is known or fixed, K is fixed, T1 and T2, the periods are fixed. So everything else is fixed. I interpret this now as a function of the sigma. I can ask myself, okay, what is the inversion of this function, the inversion of the price that I observe as a function of this parameter sigma. And this is called the implied volatility. So which volatility do you have to plug into the valuation formula to get a given price? Implied volatilities are often quoted instead of prices. So it's just a quoting convention. Yeah. So instead of asking what is the price of this option, and instead of telling you a euro amount, he tells you the volatility amount. And that means, given that he also tells you all the other parameters, you have to plug in this volatility into the valuation formula to get the price. Okay, why is that? Why are they quoting? Why are they telling you prices in terms of such complicated parameters? So the reason is that could also be a historic reason. The reason is that maybe some of these parameters here, especially actually this parameter here, maybe the L0 changes. And maybe it changes very frequently. Yeah. So for example, in the case of an option on a stock, maybe the stock price changes very frequently, but the parameter sigma bar, that corresponds to the option prices remains more stable. Then they just quote this more stable parameter because the quote is actually not so sensitive to changes. So you can use this parameter a few hours later, or even maybe a day later, and still get some reasonable price. So of course, that depends on the situation, if this is a reasonable approach. Just as a comment, there are conventions that sometimes they quote, they tell you such parameters that are associated with a certain valuation function. The next model I like to discuss is the Bachelier model. Actually, we now have the same question. It's just a different model we assume for the forward rate. So again, I consider the caplet as it was defined here in our definition. So again, we look at paying a maximum of the interest rate for the period from T1 to T2 fixed in T1 minus k and 0 times the period length. Okay, and actually I should either write here one currency unit multiplied with this, or I write here times PT2 observed in T2. So maybe something like that. That is my payoff again. And now I assume a different model. I assume the Bachelier model that assumes a normal dynamic. So I assume that L follows this stochastic process. Here the word normal refers to the fact that here my driver is just a sigma dw. Okay, and because this is normal, I use here sigma superscript n. So that is just to indicate that this is maybe not the same sigma. So it's just a different parameter now. So there will be a sigma bar superscript n that is then a different parameter. So I like to calculate the value of the caplet under this model. The whole derivation, and we can go maybe more quickly through the next sections, is very much in the line of what we did for the Black model. So this follows the same line as we did for the Black model. We choose a numerator, we move to the equivalent martingale measure, we try to get some information about the distribution of the stuff that is inside the expectation, and we calculate the integral. So what is the numerator? The numerator is also associated here again with the payment time. So this here is my indication. Check if this is maybe a good numerator. The second thing is, this is a good numerator because that guy here is a martingale under this numerator. So we choose again the T2 bond as a numerator. Okay, and I have that this guy is a martingale under the equivalent martingale measure. So my forward rate, is a martingale under the equivalent martingale measure. Because it is a portfolio of traded assets, bond minus bond in a certain fraction divided by the numerator. So hence I know that this guy has a zero DT term. So this means that DL1 is a zero DT term plus something DW. So, and you see the something dw, actually at this point I didn't care if it was a log normal or normal one. So I just want to have it become a martingale. And now I know that this guy is just sigma superscript n dwn. So I know now again the distribution, it's normal distributed. So we know that L is normal distributed, and I can immediately read off mean, which is just the initial value. So we can read off the mean, it's the initial value, and I can read off the standard deviation which is just sigma superscript n bar times square root of t, where the sigma bar superscript n is again the square root of the annualized integrated variance. Next step, the payoff which I would like to evaluate is the maximum of L minus k times period length n zero. So now I like to calculate the expectation of this divided by my numerator. So it's again that V zero divided by n zero is the expectation of V at capital T2 divided by my numerator n T2. And again, you have the same little trick that you can think of paying this here times the numerator n of T2, since my numerator is equal to 1 at T2. And then this guy here cancels with this guy. Okay, or you can think of, you have chosen the numerator very clever and it is 1. So your numerator vanishes inside the integral and you just have expectation and you just have the expectation of this function. So now I have an expectation of the maximum of some random variable which is normal distributed and zero. And you can calculate this integral. So I don't have the analytic calculation here. I just give you now the formula. So calculating this expectation gives you now the Bachelier formula, which is here. And it is also the numerator at zero multiplied with a formula that contains the index that it's paid also evaluated at zero. So it's L minus K again here, also times phi, capital phi of T plus sigma times square root of T1, the fixing time times little phi. So that is the density of T plus. Everything multiplied with our scaling T2 minus T1. Let's go back to the model. So that's here. And let's maybe compare this model to the Black-Scholes model. Or as we say, for the interest rates, to the Black model. So for the Black model, actually I had that DL was sigma times LDW. So I had that the logarithm of L was mu dt plus sigma dw. Okay, so in the Black model, our L of t was a positive. So actually, if of course the initial value is positive, so interest rates remained positive, and for the Bachelier model, this does not hold. So L of t is not guaranteed to be positive if the initial value is positive. So we can have negative interest rates here. So if you like to model negative interest rates, so maybe the Bachelier model is better. Yeah. So maybe later we can discuss other alternatives like a mixture of the two, the displaced log normal model. So actually for the option price, what does this mean? So for the option price in the Black model, there's actually an upper bound. Okay, why is there an upper bound? Can you easily see that in the formula? So maybe you can check if you can see this in the formula, but I can give you maybe a better argument. There is an upper bound because I can tell you a replication strategy that is always ensuring that you have more money in your replication portfolio than you need for the option. So the option pays maximum of the interest rates L minus K and zero. So actually it pays then less than if I just have L, because L is positive and maximum of L minus K and zero for K being positive is smaller than just L. So for positive L, actually I have an upper bound, which is just for positive K, I have an upper bound, which is just L. And I know a replication for generating the value L. That was our floater. If I want to have a replication portfolio that has exactly the value L, I buy bond at the beginning minus bond at the end divided by the period length. Okay, so I have a replication portfolio that generates more than the option payoff. So actually I have an upper bound for the value of the option, and you can check this in the formula. For the Bachelier model, this is no longer true, yeah, because the interest rates L, yeah, can become negative. So while the option payoff is always positive, the L can become negative, so L cannot serve as an upper bound. Okay, so that was maybe some nice discussion on what's the difference between the two models. So if you like to model negative interest rates, Plaque model is not so suitable. Bachelier model can model negative interest rates. And now for a very nice third case, I would like to look at the Plaque model for a swaption. So an option on the swap rate, yeah, we just have to derive this. In this last section, actually it becomes even more apparent what is the choice of numerator, so how important the choice of numerator is in the whole option formula derivation thing. And you see that the correct choice of a numerator makes the stuff much easier. Yeah. So I like to value a swaption. So a swaption is an option on a swap. So if you look into our definition of a European swaption, it was defined now not by some payoff, something paid at T2, it was defined by a value at a future point in time. So you can think of it paying the value of the swap, maximum of the value of a swap and zero at the point where you evaluate this. You can think of it paying this value, the maximum of the value of the swap, the swap evaluated in T1. So which swap? So actually we have to define the swap. So we define the swap as in our definition here. So what was that? Our definition. So that is the definition of the swap. It pays the forward rate L minus a fixed constant rate SI times the period length at the end of the period, maybe multiplied with the notional with a constant N. Okay. And we could also value the swap. So since we know the value of a floating rate payment is just this floating rate payment, so this forward rate evaluated at time little t multiplied with the bond at time little p t, that was the value of the swap. So it is L observed in little t minus s I times the period length times the value of the zero coupon bond paying at the end of the period. So So this here is a complicated valuation formula where many objects enter. Yeah. So L, which is a function of the zero Cooper bonds, P, which is a zero Cooper bonds, a sum, yeah, and product, whatever. And that gives me the value of the swap in time little t. And now my swaption is an option on this value. So here inside, you have this formula. Yeah. So here inside, you have the sum of L ti, ti plus one, observed in, okay, observed actually in t1, yeah, because I evaluate this swap here in t1, minus si times period length ti plus one minus ti. Multiplied with the zero Cooper bond at the end of the period, also evaluated at T1. Yeah, so that is the T1. So here inside you have this formula. And now I would like to calculate an option on this. To derive the value of this option, let's rewrite this complicated stuff, yeah, the maximum of this complicated stuff. So from our definition, I know that this is the payment here of the swap. That is the complicated formula that is inside the maximum function. And now there is some object that makes the stuff much simpler. So recall the definition of the swap rate. So what was the swap rate? So the swap rate, let's call it S par, was actually a stochastic process. And that stochastic process had the special property that if I plug in this swap rate into a swap, so if I use this S par at this point here, then the value of the swap is zero. So the swap rate was defined as the constant rate which I have to pay that makes the swap at par, so that levels out the floating rates, so that in expectation, the value that is paid is zero. So that was the definition of the swap rate. So this here is equal to zero. So that this guy is equal to zero was the definition of the swap rate. Okay, so if this is now my definition of the swap rate, I can actually subtract that definition from the value of the swap. So if I do one minus two, then this guy cancels. And it's just the swap rate minus the SI. Okay, so that's actually a nice thing, yeah? So you see here this multiplicator, yeah, is the same in both parts. Yeah? If you subtract from the value of the swap, a swap that has value zero, you don't make any change. But in this valuation formula, the forward rates vanish. The stochastic process vanishes. So we use here the swap rate. This here was the definition of the swap rate, the rate that makes the swap to zero. I need this in a few seconds. So I use this here And I subtract the zero from the value of my swap. So if I subtract this zero from the value of the swap, what do I have? I have that the value of the swap is the sum. I have subtracted the swap that pays the swap rate. So it was minus S par inside the swap. So it is actually then plus S par. So I just have the swap that, so I just have the swap that has the value S par, the par swap rate, minus SI times B bit length times bond that pays at the end. And if you now take, for example, all SI are equal to K, yeah, all SI are the same and are equal to K, then this here is S par, so I can move that in front of the sum, minus K, times the sum of all zero Cooper bonds. Evaluated in little t. And maybe you remember this guy here. This guy is actually a financial product. It is a portfolio of zero Cooper bonds. So this guy here is our so-called swap annuity. So let me check. So that was our definition of the swap rate. And we also defined here this swap annuity. It is this portfolio of zero Cooper bonds. So that is after this little exercise, I have rewritten the value of a swap in a different form. So the value of the swap is now the difference of the par swap rate minus K. So I assume here that all SI are being equal to K. I just want to value an option on a swap where the fixed rate is always the same. Then the value of this swap is the par swap rate minus K multiplied with the swap annuity. So multiplied with the swap annuity. So now this swap annuity is a portfolio of zero bonds. The value is larger than zero. So I can move it actually out of the maximum function. If I now calculate the maximum of the value of the swap and zero. So maximum of this stuff here and zero is the same as maximum of S par minus K and zero times the swap annuity. And this swap annuity is a very complicated sum. Yeah, so not very complicated sum, but an inverse sum. Actually, here I have made a mistake. Yeah, so this is at exercise point T1. Because the only point where I know the value of the swaption is in T1. Okay, so at an earlier slide, we had the value of the swaption in T1 is given by the maximum of the value of the swap in T1 and zero. So our first step was to rewrite the value of the swap using the swap rate, by plugging in the swap rate. And now I could rewrite the value of the swaption in this nice form here. And you see that it's actually very similar now to what we had for the caplet. It's the maximum of S par, the par swap rate, so S minus K and zero, multiplied with some financial product. the annuity. And now comes a nice surprise. This password right here. So where was it? Where's the password right? This password right is the bond that pays at the beginning minus the bond that pays at the end. So actually it was the floating rate lag. So maybe I write this below. So what was the pass swap rate? So to write it a little bit more general, the pass swap rate was the sum of the floating rate payments. So this is LTI TI plus one observed in little t times the bond TI plus one that pays at the end for all periods. So, and that was then a telescope sum, and that was then the same as the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end, divided by the swap annuity. Okay, so then it was possible to show the stuff on the top is a telescope sum, which is just the bond at the beginning minus the bond at the end. And surprise, the stuff below is our swap annuity. So the pass swap rate is now again a traded asset, namely the portfolio of two bonds plus the bond that matures in T1 minus the bond that matures in Tn, divided by the swap annuity. So you see there is the same structure again. In my option, I pay the maximum of an index minus k and zero, multiplied with a financial product, the swap annuity. And if I choose this financial product as a numerator, the index, the pass swap rate, becomes a martingale. It is a financial product, a traded asset divided by the numerator, becomes a martingale. So in the swaption, I have again a very similar structure. And you can see that the swaption pays now maximum of the swap rate minus k and zero units of the swap annuity. So and now this paying in units of suddenly becomes different. Yeah, before it was just like I have a very complicated way of expressing the payment time. Yeah, it was just a zero coupon bond that was won at a certain point in time. Now it's really that I pay you that many units of this financial product, and the units that I pay are a martingale. So now I have the same structure as for the caplet, and I can walk through the derivation again and calculate now the Plaque formula for swaption. So what we do here for the Plaque model is I assume now a log normal. Oops. So here for the Plaque model, I assume now a log normal dynamic for the swap rate. So the swap rate should be, the pass swap rate should be log normal. So that is here the dw part in my stochastic process is sigma s dw. Then I choose my numerator, and as a numerator, I choose now the swap annuity. I move to the corresponding equivalent martingale measure. We already observed that the swap rate is a martingale under this measure. So I know that the dt part is zero. So I know that the swap rate is sigma s dw. So and now I'm in this general situation. Yeah, the f is the swap rate and the M is the annuity, choosing M as a numerair, F is a martingale, F is log normal distributed. So I have Black-Scholes formula with M of zero, which is my A of zero, F of zero, which is here my S of zero, and everything else is the same. Okay. So the Bachelier model for the swaption, you can guess it, is just the same. You just choose now the Bachelier model. That is, you choose a normal model for the swap rate. And you just get Bachelier formula, yeah, with this A and the S0 now being the swap annuity and the initial value of the swap rate. Everything else is the same. Let me conclude this section with a last remark. Of course, Black and Bachelier model for swaption on the backward rate are exactly the same. So why is that? We had this nice little lemma. So our lemma 123 that told us that a swap that pays the backward rate has at an earlier time the same value than a swap that pays the forward rate. So since the swaption evaluates the swap at an earlier time, the swaption on a swap that pays the backward rate is the same as a swaption on a swap that pays the forward rate. There's one small warning. This here only applies to the swaption, because the swaption is an option on a value where the product is evaluated at the beginning of this product, at the beginning of all the periods. This does not apply to the caplet or the cap or the floorlet or the floor, because you know the backward rate is actually the performance of our small accrual account. Okay. And if you have maximum of this backward rate, minus k and zero, evaluated at the end, that makes a difference if you have maximum of the forward rate, minus k and zero, evaluated at the beginning. Yeah? So if you are at the beginning, fixed at the beginning of the period, yeah, this is different than if it is fixed at the end of the period. For the swaption, it was an option on the value of the swap, and the value of the swap was fixed at the beginning. And for that reason, the both two products are the same. So that concludes actually my my section now on these Black and Bachelier models. A nice other application which we can do in the next session is the valuation of a quanto caplet. And you will see again why this change of numerair or the choice of numerair is such an important tool. And certain choices of the numerair make things easier than other choices. So thanks. That was it for today.